Everybody, let's get started. This panel is known as Combating Overcriminalization. Being the only non-lawyer on the panel, I was told to be short and to the point, and since I already delivered on half of that, let's just lay out the ground rules and get started. So if you can, please turn off your cell phones. This will be available. This is being recorded. This will be available shortly after. Please turn off your cell phones. We're going to go 40 minutes of question and answer, of moderated discussion, and then we will have a little bit of time for question and answer. Please save your questions to the end, just so we can really kind of lay out the broad scope of the policy areas that we're going to be discussing today. And without further ado, let's go through this and announce our speakers. So starting immediately to my left is Representative Matt Krause. He's a constitutional attorney, college professor of American history and government, and public speaker on America's founding fathers. He and his business partner also work with financial institutions, businesses, nonprofits, and churches on how to creatively reward and retain employees, and also putting transitions in place for those institutions. Matt just completed his second term in the state legislature. He represents District 93 in Tarrant County, and his district includes part of Fort Worth and Arlington. This session, Matt served on the Corrections and Land and Resource Management Committees. To his left is Representative Matt Rinaldi. Starting to notice a theme here. He was elected to the Texas House of Representatives in 2014 to represent the northwest portion of Dallas County. He sits on both the Committee on Business and Industry and the Committee on Agriculture and Livestock. He attended James Madison University in Virginia, where he graduated cum laude with his BBA in Economics, and Boston University School of Law, where he earned his JD. Currently a commercial litigation attorney and strong advocate of tort reform in the legal community. Matt also serves on the board of directors for a publicly traded real estate investment trust and in the hotel and hospitality industry. To his left is Shannon Edmonds. He is the Director of Governmental Relations at TDCAA, the Texas District County Attorneys Association. He has degrees from the University of Texas, both undergrad and law school, and he was a prosecutor in Travis County from 1993 to 2000. To his left is Vikrant Reddy. Vikrant is a former TPPF employee. He was here back when I started, if that dates me. He's a senior research fellow at the Charles Koch Institute. Reddy previously served here where he launched the Right on Crime campaign. He also worked as a research assistant at the Cato Institute. He's a graduate from the University of Texas at Austin, and he learned his law degree at the Southern Methodist University. So without further ado, I figure we could start on really talking about the boundaries of the criminal law. So, you know, let's start out with something a little more light. What is the purpose of criminal law? And who'd like to go first?
I'll go first. That is as philosophical a question as it gets, right? Why do we even have a criminal law? And so I'll give you the answer that philosophers give. They say we basically do this for four reasons. First one is probably the most obvious one. Everybody can hear me, by the way, right? Okay, good. Incapacitation. Let's just get this person who's a threat to public safety off the streets. That's reason number one. That's the most obvious. Second one's also pretty intuitive. Deterrence. Let's make sure that other people in the community who may think about becoming similar threats to public safety in the future are deterred from engaging in this type of behavior. That makes a lot of sense also. The third one that people talk about is rehabilitation. When somebody has done something to undermine public safety in a significant way, they are broken or damaged in some way. You want to fix them. You want to make them better. You want to get them back out there being productive citizens again. And the fourth one, and this is where things get a little controversial, is retribution. A certain sense that, look, you've just done something wrong and you've got to be held accountable. It's not that controversial to me. I think that that makes a lot of sense. But I think among the philosopher crowd, that one gets a little controversial. But those are sort of your four big reasons: incapacitate, deter, rehabilitate, retributive justice.
And I would say, just philosophically, if you're going to be a nation of laws, you've got to have some structure, right, for those laws. And we talk about liberty and the pursuit of happiness. you have to do that within some kind of certain framework or paradigm or mechanism. And so to do that, you have to make sure that you're punishing those who do wrong and rewarding those who do well. So if you're going to punish those who do wrong, it needs to be something that's applied even-handedly, that's done principally and done in a knowable way. And that's where criminal law, I think, comes into play, which is why one of the big reasons we're working on overcriminalization is when you overcriminalize, it takes away the confidence from the populace, the citizenry, that the government is abiding by the rule of law and doing what it's supposed to, because it seems like criminal law is meted out arbitrarily. And so I think philosophically, if you're going to be a nation of laws under the rule of law, you got to have some parameters within which to live, and that goes to criminal law, which has to be some punishment for those who step outside of those boundaries at certain times.
Actually, that's a very interesting point you made. You said knowingly. So we actually had several items of legislation up before before Congress this last year on what's known as mens rea. Now, mens rea is an element that we don't really discuss much here in Texas simply because, it's something we took care of pretty early on. Shannon, if you could just kind of generally explain what mens rea is and basically where could federal lawmakers perhaps take a page out of our playbook?
Sure, Derek. So mens rea or scienter is what makes a crime. Okay, if somebody does something by accident, we don't criminalize it by and large. So most crimes require one of four mental states, mens rea: intentional, knowing, reckless, or we do have a criminal negligence standard that is rarely used but is on the books. So when the legislature creates a new offense, they're going to usually write that statute that says a person commits an offense if the person intentionally or knowingly blank, or if the person recklessly X. What you find, though, in some of the offenses that are not in our penal code, many times the legislature will create an offense that doesn't have that language about the mental state in it. So many years ago, the legislature, we have a default in our penal code that says if the offense language doesn't require a mental state, we're going to require that it at least be done with criminal recklessness, okay, that they recklessly do that. And what that means in Texas is that, I mean, they may not have intended for that result to occur, but they knew that there was a substantial likelihood that that was going to occur, and they did it anyway, and a normal person would not have ignored that risk. That's what reckless means. And so that's the floor kind of for us. But the feds don't have that kind of default mens rea requirement, and they have their laws scattered all over the place. And so I know that's something that, it's not something that our association gets involved in. We kind of stick to our bailiwick in Austin, but I know a lot of folks have been working on that in Washington. And certainly if anybody asked me what the feds should do, I'd say, as prosecutors, we don't have any problem with having a recklessness standard on these what offenses that would other be strict liability, which would mean regardless of what you were thinking or what you intended, if you did it, you're guilty. And that's not usually how we make something a crime.
You know, Shannon, I can tell you, since I'm unfortunately living in Washington, D.C. now, among people who are working on that legislation to reform corrections and sentencing at the federal level last year, a lot of people believe that a big part of why it didn't happen is because the feds refused to engage on this mens rea stuff that you're talking about.
That brings up a good point when it actually comes to creation of the law. So gentlemen, when actually crafting a criminal law, you know, then again, you know, malice has been around for a while, so we're not exactly pioneering new waters every day. What is the process of rationalization when we are generating a new crime? And help us understand that as a legislator, kind of what the checklist looks like going through that.
Well, you know, the first thing I do and discuss with my staff and my colleagues when we're talking about creating a new crime is, does the new crime need to be created? Or is it already covered under existing law? And I can tell you 95% of the time, it's already covered under existing law. It's one of those crimes that's been on the books since the start of human society, like theft or something else. So we're just creating this system of redundant laws that inadvertently pulls in other conduct, which most of us might not think is a crime. So, you know, you often point to the absurd examples of you know, what's been made illegal in the state of Texas. And I know TPPF had one of the speakers pointed to 13 oyster-related felonies in the state of Texas on the books currently. And I was thinking of one of those, which is stealing oysters from a private oyster bed, which is a felony. Well, that's theft. And most of what we see is creating a crime and adding to the list of crimes that's already illegal in some way. I think what the panel was saying before was very important. We need to know what the law is, especially the criminal law, in order to have faith in it. And every time we add a new criminal violation, it makes it harder for the average person to understand if they're breaking the law every day. So that's what I look for. Is it needed? And if it's not redundant, should it be illegal? And what should the punishment be?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. You had that horrific incident out of Chicago, I guess it was last week or the week before, where that handicapped individual was beaten and tortured and kidnapped. And there was a lot of talk on hate crimes, and these individuals should be charged with hate crimes. Well, if you look at the statutory language, the hate crime is actually a lesser charge than everything else you could be charged with. So sometimes it feels good, it sounds good to charge people or to put new law on the books, but you're not really making society any safer, any better, or any more knowable of what we can and cannot do just by putting certain things in place. So as Representative Rinaldi said, I think that's one thing we look at is, are we actually making a difference here? My college basketball coach used to tell me, don't mistake activity for achievement. And a lot of times in the legislature, I think we try to just be active and do something without achieving anything. So we want to make sure if we're targeting something, if we're going after something, it's actually going to make a difference.
I would actually like to focus on something that Representative Rinaldi said and actually ask a question of you, Representative Krause. So you actually kind of pioneered the effort to actually catalog a lot of these offenses, these more amorphous crimes that exist outside the penal code, and commissioned a commission, as people are wont to do with commissions, that actually studied and enumerated these laws. And this report, the commission to study and review certain penal laws, came out earlier in December. Now, this enumerates things in here that, to Representative Rinaldi's point, are, you know, already a crime. I believe it is a third-degree felony to slander a credit union. You know, which of course we all know the civil recourse for that. So, what kind of motivated you to really charge this hill to enumerate these laws and to perhaps have them cataloged for future discussion?
Yeah, I'd say the biggest motivator sitting to my far left was Vikrant. We talked at the beginning of last session, and he said, hey, we think this is a good idea. What do you think about carrying it? And so we talked a little bit about it, and as Representative Rinaldi said, if you dredge for oysters at midnight or you thrash a pecan tree, you can go to jail or pay some serious fines. And so it just went to that idea that if you want to know what you can and cannot do, it should be in the penal code, right? We shouldn't have all these administrative codes and all these sections that have these little laws that tell you, you know, what are you supposed to do or not do. And so Vikrant and I talked about it, and I thought it was a really good idea. And so we put forward the bill, had a great hearing on it. Paul Workman was actually kind enough to allow us to attach that to one of his criminal justice reform bills. And then Senator Burton over in the Senate did a great job of making sure that it got across the finish line. But it was just that idea that, you know, we should know what's right and what's wrong. We had 1,500 laws outside of the penal code for which you could go to jail or face some kind of criminal penalty. And so the commission's done a great job. My staff, Clay and Spence, who are here today, are working on the recommendations that the commission put into place. So hopefully we're going to have at least three bills, maybe more. One's going to repeal a bunch of the old, archaic, antiquated language. Some's going to modify if it shouldn't be a criminal penalty. Maybe it should just be a civil penalty. And some's just going to probably move it from that administrative agency code to the penal code so that it's more knowable and more easily accessible.
Such as 62.005 in the Parks and Wildlife Code, hunting with light.
Yes.
And I wanted to point out one thing also, because you said antiquated language. I want to point that, like, when you initially hear these things, you're thinking, oh, what year was that thing passed in? That was probably a 19th century enactment. I heard the bank slander of a bank, and I, you know, thought it was something from the 30s and the bank failures. That was passed in 1997. You know, we heard a law that makes it you can be put in jail for 3 months for the unlawful shaking of a pecan tree that isn't yours, and that was passed in 2001.
Oh, wow.
I know. I mean, unlawful bingo was like 1999. I mean, these are new laws. These aren't laws that have been on the books forever. So that's something to keep in mind. We're still passing these crazy, crazy criminal penalties that you know, you scoff at when you hear it. But this is stuff that's recently enacted.
Representative, when I was here in, I think, 2013, maybe 2011, lying in a fishing tournament was criminalized.
Okay, that's really legitimate, but no.
don't be that guy in the fishing tournament. Yeah. That's
right. Well, if I could follow up on something that Representative Rinaldi said, is it is still occurring. Okay, we keep track of legislation as it's filed. Anything that would create a new offense, we follow, so that when the session is done, any of those that pass, we have to go out and train prosecutors and law enforcement officers on what these new crimes are. Right yeah. now, so there, I think, well, I did a study Wednesday. I ran a report. Okay, there are 50 bills that would create a new crime in Texas as of right now. And we're only about maybe a quarter of the way through yeah. our bill filing.
Yeah.
So I give you an idea. If you can do the quick math, I went to law school because I can't do math. But that'll tell you how many new bills are filed to create new crimes. And some of them are things that you have heard a lot about, like the bill to criminalize statewide using your cell phone while you drive. Okay, yeah. And that's a big issue. It's been publicized. But most of them do not get anywhere near that kind of attention. And so, you know, the bill to about slandering a bank, that goes through the banking committees at the legislature. Nobody there, there are no prosecutors or defense lawyers or anybody there to talk about those bills. And so it gets done without any input from people in the criminal justice system. And many of these 50 bills, one of them was suggested by a prosecutor's office, one out of 50. And that's about standard. I usually get prosecutors who will have three or four ideas for things that aren't covered by the current law. One of the things that we do, just like Representative Veronica said, is the first question to ask yourself is, are you just taking something that's already against the law and making it more against the law than it already was? Because we don't really need that, right? You only need to find these loopholes, and usually it has to do with technology, okay? So we've passed crimes to deal with, improper photography, upskirting, online solicitation. Those are all things that weren't in the penal code 15 mm-hmm. years ago because the technology didn't exist to commit them. So that's one area where there can be some legitimate change, but the vast majority of the bills filed to create new crimes are flat out not needed. But they get done because someone is getting paid to pass that bill, right? These lobby groups have their little boutique, we call them boutique crimes. So yes, it's theft to take somebody's pecans, but if the pecan tree growers lobby wants special protection, they come to the legislature and they get it done. So, you know, we have theft. We used to have 16 different kinds of theft in Texas. And when we rewrote our penal code, we all got it down into one statute. Well, now if you look in there, we have theft, but then we have theft. If it's livestock, it's more. If it's theft of certain types of animals, it's more. If it's theft of certain type of property, certain types of metals, then it's a higher punishment. So again, the system, unfortunately, is just set up to constantly add these types of offenses. And so it's great to have a mechanism for going back through some of these things and culling out the ones that have probably never been used in many cases.
Yeah.
But some lobbyist somewhere was getting paid by his clients to pass a bill to make them feel good about themselves, to make them feel special. And the law enforcement people didn't want it, but it's on the books, and it makes it harder for us to find and use the laws we really want to enforce, which is why it's a great idea to go through those.
Yeah. Well, I was going to point out, and lobbyists aren't the only ones who need to feel special. Legislators like to feel special, too. So when your district is the pecan capital of Texas, you want to be able to go home and say, look it, I passed a bill, I did something, I accomplished it. And as long as legislators keep defining accomplishment as passing a bill with their name up top, we have a big issue, and this will continue.
You know, Derek, I've got the report open up here on my iPad that Representative Krause called for in his legislation 2 years ago. This goes through all these crazy criminal laws. There's a sentence that I found so chilling, I just want to read it. And it simply says, the commission looked at all these things. They said, in many cases, A criminal penalty seemed to be no more than an afterthought. That's a criminal penalty is the most extraordinary power that Representative Krause and Rinaldi and our legislators have. The notion that they just chucked it in as an afterthought, that's a quote, is really terrifying to me.
I'd actually like to build off that. So, Shannon, you mentioned some of the lobbies, and yes, I'll try to tamp down. I don't like big pecan impugned on my panels. But a lot of this, and we don't have a lot of this here in Texas, but federally we do. We have a really, really pernicious problem of administrative law, of criminal penalties coming without any sort of legislative ambit whatsoever. So Vikrant, speaking entirely for Washington, can you explain a little bit of how does administrative law, how does regulatory law, how does it promulgate? How do we get criminal penalties that we may be subject to without a single person that we put in office voting on it?
We learn, like in the fourth grade, right, that we have these three branches of government, legislative, executive, judicial, and they're all supposed to check each other, and it seems to make intuitive sense. But what has started to happen increasingly in the last several decades is that the legislative branch, rather than being very definite and precise about what they want to do, will just be very broad, and they'll kick the rest of it over to executive branch agencies. And they'll say, you fill in the gap. So, for example, I forget the exact number, but in the Obamacare legislation, there are dozens upon dozens of instances. You can run a control F, where it says, the Secretary of Health and Human Services. And it's their instruction that, okay, here's broadly what we're trying to achieve, you figure it out. And so all of these administrative agency heads start putting together rules, and they're punishable with criminal sanctions. And the people who are putting those rules together were never elected. These are people who are appointed and who just kind of became lifelong bureaucrats. It's a huge problem in Washington, D.C. In, I think, the first criminal laws in the country, the federal criminal laws, were produced in 1790. There were 23 of them. Now there's something like 5,000 federal criminal laws. It's a big problem. But within administrative agency rules that have criminal sanctions attached to them, that figure is estimated to be about 300,000. I mean, it is staggering how widespread the problem is. At the federal level, it's absolutely out of control.
Gentlemen, especially those with a background in constitutional law, what can we do?
Well, you know, I fault the Congress a lot for doing that. I think they've abdicated their role. They've delegated their responsibility. It's so much easier for them to say, oh, you know what, Secretary so-and-so put that in, or let's pass a big bill and let the administrative agencies figure it out. So I think we have to be loud and vocal with our congressmen and women in the Senate and the House and say, no, I mean, that's your job. That's what I tell people all the time. I get frustrated when we always talk about school finance or other things, saying, let's let the courts decide. No, that's what we're elected for. And if Representative Rinaldi and I make the wrong vote or do the wrong thing, then you can take us out of office, but we're the ones who are supposed to be making those hard decisions. That's the same way with the Congress and the Senate. They're supposed to be making those decisions, not some secretary or administrative agency that's unaccountable. So I think we have to hold their feet to the fire and make sure they're not abdicating their responsibility because they want to, and it's a lot easier for them.
Certainly, certainly. So one of the things, another area where we see criminal law start to crop up independent of actual, you know, per se malice, tends to be an area of occupational licensing, and that's something that we've worked on here at TPPF as well. So in occupational licensing, we really haven't yet, no, I say we, I just mean people that research this, people that pass laws, we really haven't defined what are the contours of licensure, what should licensure accomplish, and where should it exist and where should it not exist. That's a very open-ended question, gentlemen.
I think the only place that occupational licensure should exist is where there's a health and safety interest to be protected. Now, that's a kind of blurry bounds, right? But I think as long as we're having the health and safety argument whenever an occupational licensing bill comes up, we're winning, because we're not even having that argument right now. People are coming up and introducing bills, for example, to license roofers. Why? Because people are being defrauded. Well, there's a judicial remedy for people being defrauded. It doesn't have to do with health or safety. It's to enforce a law where there's a judicial remedy. So I think we need to narrow the scope of the argument too. Is there a health or public health or safety interest being protected?
And I think you could look, are they better served by having the government do it or by having their own industry or association doing it, right? I mean, there's a lot of industries that self-select or self-police themselves, and I think a lot of times that's more effective and more efficient in the first place. So a lot of times we get people coming to our office saying, we need to regulate this. Well, has your industry thought about regulating themselves, doing a voluntary certification or credential that you can distinguish yourself on? So the remedy isn't always the government steps in. And if I go back to our last point just real quick, I think it's incumbent upon Republicans, of which I'm one, who have decried President Obama for the last 8 years of going around the constitutional process and the congressional process, that if the current administration or soon to be current administration does the same thing, that we're just as vocal and we're just as loud about that. Because so many times it seems like we don't want him to do that, but we really want to get this done. So if he can just do it maybe a little bit outside the bounds, we'll be okay with it this time. I think we've got to be as consistent now as we've been the last 8 years. And Vikrant and I were talking about it earlier. So it's not partisan, it's principled. So
let me just build off on the licensure point. So if it is something that even does protect a health and safety interest, would necessarily criminal penalties be the best route to that, philosophically speaking?
Well, I can tell you that I've yet to meet a prosecutor who went to college and incurred school debt and went to law school to incur school debt to get out so he could prosecute some dentist for not paying his dues or letting something slide. It's not a good use of that local government's time or resources to have that in the criminal justice system. If they defrauded someone, we're going to prosecute those roofers for theft, right? It all comes under theft. The legislature has many other tools, and we used to see bills. I don't see this so much anymore, which is a tribute to some of the work TPPF has done to bring this to light. But we used to see bills that would deal with an occupational issue, and it would create an administrative penalty for some unelected board to rule on. Then it would create a civil penalty for either an individual who is harmed or for usually the attorney general or sometimes the local county district attorney to enforce civilly. And then it would provide a criminal penalty all for the same conduct. That makes no sense. And so I'm glad that we're seeing less of that, but there are still a lot of those things that are on the books. And I think certainly in our profession, we think those are things that should be handled either administratively, or if it's something that the legislature wants to give the AG to do, if it rises to that level of importance, that's great. Or if not, you always have the civil justice system for that person to seek the remedy.
So let me point out too, you brought up a great point, which is the same conduct is a civil crime, is a civil penalty, it's subject to a criminal penalty. Like for example, in the area of Medicaid, if you're a dental office and you're accused, there's some billing irregularities and you're accused of Medicaid fraud, well, you're going to have an action against you by the Office of the Inspector General in Texas for a civil penalty. Then the Attorney General of Texas is going to bring an action against you for criminal penalty. And don't forget, you'd have two layers of enforcement. It's also a federal crime. So you'd also have the U.S. Attorney General's Office, Department of Justice, bringing an action against you as well. Mm-hmm. So how do you resolve this? Well, you have to negotiate with three different governmental entities, get them all on the same page just to get rid of the criminal penalties against you. It can take years. It can bankrupt you. Just because you have different entities and different prosecutors, up against you. You have to get three different entities on the same page.
That's a very, very good point. Let's get a little more into the weeds on some of the procedural issues. So, Shannon, I'm gonna kick this to you. So last year there was some substantive changes in some of the grand jury process. However, I think we, especially those up here on this panel, we probably take for granted that, everyone knows what the grand jury is, right? It's in the Constitution, so therefore, we all know about it. I think Justice Willett mentioned that might be one of the areas where civic education is shortcoming yesterday. Can you give us just a little primer on what the actual grand jury is and what that change last year was?
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up Justice Willett's talk, because I know that he mentioned the problem that we have in poor civic involvement in this state. I'm sorry. Justice Willis pointed out the problem we have in the state of low civic involvement. Well, a grand jury is a perfect example. in part because of some of the legislation that passed last session. So we had a bill that eliminated one of the ways you could get a grand jury together. And a grand jury is usually 12 to 14 people who meet in secret to hear allegations against other citizens and decide whether or not there's sufficient probable cause to believe that a crime was committed and that this particular person committed that crime. And then they refer that, they hand up an indictment to the court, and these are only felonies, by the way. They hand up an indictment to the court if at least nine of them so believe, and then that starts the court process of a criminal case. If a grand jury, we use the term no bills, if less than nine of them decide that, if less than nine of them can agree that there's just some information that a crime was committed and this person did it, then they no-bill that person, okay? And that charge never gets formally filed. And that's one of the reasons why it's done in secret, is to protect the reputation of those who are suspected of something but aren't charged. Here's the problem, is you have to find citizens who are willing to take time out of their day for weeks mm-hmm. or months to serve in this very important check on the criminal justice system. And it's very hard to find folks, especially in rural parts of the state, all right? And so in Travis County, and let me ask this, how many of you have been on a grand jury? Is there anybody here who's been on a grand jury? So you know about the type of service that I'm talking about. It can be very time consuming. If you're in an urban area, you might meet for 3 months, but you're gonna meet once or twice a day for a couple hours a day. Who can take that time out of their work, right? So it's very difficult to find people who can fit that into their schedule. One of the things the legislature did last session, based on a horror story, right? We know horror stories are great for getting laws passed, but it won a reporter a Pulitzer out of Harris County. But the legislative solution to this murder case where something was done improperly in the grand jury was to change how grand juries get selected and to require them to just be selected the way any other trial jury, appellate jury, selected, which is you line up, the first 14 of you, if you're qualified, you're on the grand jury, to avoid judges cherry-picking who gets on a grand jury. That's fine. The problem right now we have is that a clerk, by law, can only call 125 people for a grand jury. Now, you would think that would be plenty. We have county after county in rural areas who cannot, first of all, they call 125 people, they get about 25 who show up. And then when they're told the time commitment, I can't do that. I'd lose my job. My company would go under. I couldn't put food on the table for my family. And so there is a provision that literally allows, it's antiquated. It allows the sheriff to go out and literally pull people off the street and say, hey, would you like to be on a grand jury? And that's how some of these counties are having to fill their grand juries because of the legislation that was passed. That was one of these unintentional consequences that we talked about. And then the other problem is it was designed to try to make grand juries more diverse so that a judge couldn't go and pick 12 people that look just like him or her and put them on that grand jury. Well, the problem is many judges were using that ability to pick people to make sure their grand juries were diverse. And now that they just have to rely on who shows up, well, anybody who's getting paid hourly, they're not coming to be on a grand jury. They can't afford it, okay? And a lot of people who aren't civically involved are not showing up. So now you're getting grand juries that are less diverse in some parts of the state than they were before. And that's a problem as well. So I know that the clerks and some prosecutors are going to look at some alternatives to kind of tweak that or maybe bracket it to allow the rural jurisdictions to do it. But it's a very important job because these are the people who are supposed to be grading law enforcement's paper and prosecutor's paper initially to see whether or not this person should be formally charged.
Certainly, I'm going to push back on it just a little. So we saw, especially in the run up to the elimination, and the system was colloquially known as the pick a pal system. We saw a little bit in the run up that there was, certain selection effects that were permeating their way into grand jury. And let me ask some of you gentlemen this: as a competing liberty interest, what is a way that we can actually strike a balance between the needs of an efficient prosecutorial system, which we need? which we need for public safety, and also the liberty interests of the citizenry?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think it's a fine line. It's a delicate balance. I don't know if you're, I mean, you come to find out no law is absolutely perfect in its application every time. Every time you put one law on the books, somebody's going to have an issue or a problem, or it's going to create an issue or loophole there. I know talking to Shannon last year about our Penal Code Commission, I was all gung-ho about getting rid of 1,100 laws, just like Minnesota did and all this stuff. And he said, well, let's, you know, you got to make sure you're doing it the right way and getting rid of the right things and not creating havoc. Remember that at our last panel? And so that was really good. I'm getting choked up just thinking about it. Yeah. So I think input from those who are administering these services are really good. I hadn't heard some of those unintended consequences, Shannon, so those are really good. But I think you always want to err on the side of liberty, but you also want to be cognizant of the actual real-life applications of what the laws are doing.
I guess broader than the context of grand juries, you're asking the question, just in criminal law in general. You know, like I had said in the beginning, I think you need a specific and narrow group of a narrow range of conduct that's subject to criminal penalties, so that each individual citizen knows what they are and can grasp the conduct that's prohibited. And I think, you know, we have to protect Fourth Amendment rights before somebody's, you know, before somebody's arrested. We need to protect their rights during trial and give them the benefit of the doubt. And then once a person's convicted and found guilty, after being given every benefit of the doubt and after upholding their Fourth Amendment rights prior to arrest, then I think we need punishment that fits the crime. And I think it should be, you know, with retribution in mind, with rehabilitation in mind, and with deterrence in mind. And I think that's usually how I approach the, you know, every criminal question that comes up.
And that definitely is a great segue into kind of where I'd like to bracket the last bit of our discussion here. So, gentlemen, y'all just gaveled into the 85th legislature. You know, so, I mean, a lot of sitting around, not a lot of stuff going on in the beginning. So when the flurry starts, especially when it comes to criminal law, and Shannon definitely mentioned a few of them already, in this general area, what do you think we can expect?
Well, I think there's a movement, thanks to TPPF and others, right on crime, the work Mark Levin, I see him back there, the work he's done for years, the work Vikrant has done. I think we're starting to see a very big bipartisan movement towards this criminal justice reform. And I think it's growing steady but surely. And so I think we're going to continue to see getting rid of licensing and regulations and not adding new ones to occupations. I think we're going to continue to see criminal justice reform getting rid of some of our laws on the books and, you know, criminalizing the people that we're scared of, not that we're mad at. And so I think we're going to continue to see movement along that. I think civil asset forfeiture is an area where we might be able to make some real big gains this year. And so I think there's movement there. I can't tell you exactly what it's going to be, but I hope by the end of sine die, we'll look back and say we've done things to shore up our criminal justice system and make Texas a better, more efficient place for its citizens.
Yeah, I think civil asset forfeiture reform is so important this session. I think we have the support to get it done. I think another issue is going to be privacy. Privacy laws and privacy in law enforcement is going to be an issue. And I do think there's going to be a movement to decriminalize some behavior. However, I don't know. I look at these 50 laws that are proposed, and I know many of them will pass, unfortunately. You know, we have to be loud and we have to be vocal in order to keep that from happening, because the mood of the legislature is always to say yes to everything that comes down. That was the biggest surprise I had in the legislature, is the amount of times everybody says yes and everyone jokes, and, you know, even to the extent that they stole my yes button during the budget debates. But but everyone jokes and I say no all the time, but we took a catalog of my votes. And I said no more than anyone else in the legislature, and I voted yes 70% of the time. So you could see how much, you know, these bills will come up, and people will vote yes through committee. They'll vote yes, 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 unless, you know, unless somebody makes a vocal stand against them.
Well, we are all getting along so nice. I'm not going to talk about civil asset forfeiture. Yeah. we'll
talk about that. I wonder what you were thinking on that.
we'll talk about that another day. Yeah. We welcome that discussion. It's always something that the legislature should look at, and they have been for a long time. In general, one of the things that we always comment, I follow about 12 to 1,300 bills every session. They get filed that affect something a prosecutor could do. Now, part of that is a statement on how much the legislature has asked prosecutors to do. That's a lot, probably too much, but we just have to follow whatever may touch their job duties. But many of those bills are things that have been filed again and again, or there are things that we've debated again and again, like the death penalty and things like that. So I always like to kind of keep my own interest, because this is going to be my ninth session, and to keep me interested, I always look for what's new. And one of the things that we're really getting a new push on is a focus on mental health. And I think that's good, and that's something that I know TPPF and folks on the left have worked on. I think, the guy who shot up the airport in Florida the other day had been committed civilly for a few days and then released for mental health and given his weapons back, which he then took down to Florida and used. And I think we tweeted out, if someone tells you we can't afford to fix mental health, you tell them we can't afford not to, because it's such a huge portion of the people that we have to deal with in the criminal justice system. And I don't know what the solution is. I'm not going to put that out. But, when you have someone who is clearly mentally ill and has committed some heinous crime, and we can't do anything with them in the criminal justice system until they are made competent, and they have to wait 1 year in a county jail before they can get a bed spot at a state hospital to be brought back to competency so that we can handle this criminal case, that's a problem. That has ripple effects throughout the criminal justice system, and they're all negative for everybody, for that offender, for the county, for law enforcement, for the victims, for everybody. So that's clearly something that needs to be touched. We also do a lot of the CPS work, so I know we're getting out, but that has a big interaction with the criminal justice system, the juvenile justice system. So we are very encouraged that the legislature seems intent, especially in the House, that the speaker's made that one of his priorities to try to fix what has gone wrong there. And then another thing we're having a big problem with, and these are all kind of appropriations items, unfortunately, is crime labs. If we're gonna rely on cool whiz-bang forensics, we gotta have cool whiz-bang forensics that work and that are reliable and that people can trust. And so I know DPS is gonna ask for, the legislature was great in providing some brick and mortar money about 10 years ago to create a bunch of new labs throughout the state. Now, we don't have enough people to staff them and to do the work. And so when you get some stop in a drug case, or say it's a DWI case, and the person has their blood sample taken pursuant to a search warrant, and it takes 6 months to get that result back, it just grinds the entire system to a halt, and it doesn't do anybody any good. And so those are the kind of things that I think you're going to hear prosecutors talking about. It's really less about, it's more kind of taking, helping us be more efficient. Always keeping in mind, though, in the criminal justice system, the Constitution isn't efficient. The Bill of Rights wasn't put there to be efficient. We understand that. But we want to, within the bounds of the Bill of Rights, try to do things as quickly, efficiently, and as justly as we can.
And Vikrant is a Beltway insider. Let me modify that question into two parts. So, same question applicable to federal criminal justice law. Mm-hmm. And also, what is your general prospect on this incoming administration insofar as that is concerned?
I am slightly more optimistic than most people, and that shocks a lot of folks. Now, I'm not naive. It's going to be a little bit difficult on a lot of sentencing and corrections issues that folks on this panel care a lot about, because Mr. Trump seems less interested in those kinds of things, and his new Attorney General, Senator Sessions, certainly seems less interested in those sorts of things. But there are ways that you can work with people who are skeptical. You know, if you would have said to me in, I guess it would have been 2006, after Governor Perry was reelected, that the state of Texas is about to embark on major
criminal justice reform that's going to become a model for the nation, I would have said that does not sound very likely at all. And yet that's exactly what happened in the following legislative session. There are places you can work together with the new presidential administration. The most obvious one is the stuff we're talking about right now, overcriminalization. Another thing that if I were advising him, and I am not, that I would say to him is, you know, the folks who elected you, your core constituency, your base, these blue-collar guys who are a little down on their luck right now in the Midwest and parts of New England, this is where the opioid crisis has hit the hardest. And you want to reach out to this community, consolidate this community, and consolidate this voting block. You're going to want to reach out to them in terms of drug treatment, drug rehabilitation, mental health, the kinds of things Shannon was just talking about. And I would think that that's actually something that this administration is uniquely positioned, both for political and policy reasons, to do some really good things on. And I would not rule that out, because I'm sure there are plenty of people who are saying these things to him and to Mr. Sessions right now. So we'll see. I'm slightly more positive than others.
Actually, and we have just a few minutes left in this discussion. I want to make sure to ask it just so it gets out there as well. Shannon, you mentioned mental health, and I think that is definitely one of the areas where we're engaging in, and there's a lot of general interest in the actual prosecution of a case in which there is an element of, say, acute mental health crisis. How does that change the contours of the prosecutor's job, and maybe what legislation could better facilitate what y'all need to accomplish?
Gosh, Derek, that's a pretty broad question.
I'm a good moderator.
Yeah. I'll say this. We talked about, Bikrant went through the purposes of punishment, why we do that, which is that's every prosecutor's jury voir dire. In Texas, we let juries decide sentences if the defendant wants it, which is only us in Oklahoma give juries 100% of that job. And that's great, because you get the community's input on that specific act and that specific person. But when you're thinking of those things, deterrence, incapacitation, rehabilitation, and the problem, and the person has this mental health problem, it skews all of the math on that. Mm-hmm. If they have a condition that, nothing causes someone to commit a crime, but if they have a condition that lowers their impulse control or contributes to them committing a crime that they wouldn't have committed if they were in a right state, and we can treat that, then that totally changes the math on how you deal with these folks. And that's why you've seen an increasing number of mental health courts come up, especially in the urban areas, to try to divert some of these folks from the criminal justice system and give them the treatment that they need. Because ultimately the goal for those people that we don't need to incapacitate because they're too dangerous, is the ultimate goal for our folks is we don't want to see them again. Mm-hmm. We don't need repeat customers. We got enough people moving here from California already. They're going to, you know, do stuff. So we don't want to see them again. And in a significant number of offenders, mental health is a key aspect of making that a reality.
To that point, you might just mention the history of when the state legislatures all over the country decided that the mental health, state mental health system was either inefficient or unjust, and they released all the inmates.
Deinstitutionalization.
Might address that, and it's caused a problem.
Well, there's an elected prosecutor who will remain nameless who said, you know, we need to, what happened to the state school system? What happened to the state mental health system? We need to bring that back. And I thought, how are we going to bring back the 1950s? I mean, that's when the state used to pick up a big part of the tab for that. And I just don't see it happening like it used to be. There is an effort to do more locally and to try to treat people if they're in your local county jails. But I will say at some point, the state is probably going to need to pick up the slack. We have less than 2,000 beds for the commitment of the mentally ill who are in the criminal justice system throughout the state. That is the same number we had in 1993. Mm. We have not increased the number of state beds for forensic commitments in more than 20 years. I think we've had a few more people come to this state since 1993. And so I don't know how much longer we can continue to ignore that type of problem.
And what a great segue into question and answer time. But before we do, a round of applause for our panel, please. All right, well, thank you very much, gentlemen. So now we will go into the question and answer segment of the program. However, I need to underscore that it is a question and answer segment. If you go past the 40-second shot clock, it's probably no longer a question. So in respect for everybody's time, let's get started. Down here in front. Go ahead.
I just want to know more about civil asset forfeiture. And for those who may not know what it is, if you could briefly describe what it is. But are either of you going to bring a bill on that? Do we go through a different person? Is it better to go through workmen? Do you have the speaker's support on it? What do you see as shaping up for actually solving the problem? Because it just absolutely defies property rights in a state that claims to be so strong on property rights.
Just a few simple questions.
You've been taking this.
Yeah, I'm not planning on carrying a bill right now. Are you?
No, I don't have a bill on it. There will be a bill.
There have been 12 bills filed so far that amend that section of the Code of Criminal Procedure in one regard or another.
Yeah, and he's very happy about all of those bills being filed.
That's right. Well, my guess is it'll go through criminal jurisprudence again, and that's where it'll be debated. So I would look at whoever ends up being on the Criminal Jurisprudence Committee and see if there's any authors on that, and that will probably be the one that has the most momentum or best chance of going through. If not, I know Jeff Leach has worked on it in the past. Joe Moody may have worked on it, and I think he's been on CrimJur. So I think that's going to be the best bet for that. But I think it's, as Representative Rinaldi said earlier, it's an issue that's been built up. We've seen a lot of other states move on it, even since the last time we were in session. And so I look forward to working on that to reform our process and talking with Shannon about it along the way.
Mr. Edmonds, you had mentioned about the grand jury changes and how a lot of people were not responding and how sheriffs were driving around and hauling people off the sidewalk. What is the penalty for refusing to participate?
That's a good question. I'm not sure there is one for failing to reply to a grand jury summons. I know there is one for a petit jury, and I don't want to talk
about
it.
Sounds like a law we need to make.
So, yeah, another crime, 51. Yeah. You don't want people to be on a grand jury who don't want to be there. It is a significant inconvenience to the people who have to do it, and God bless the ones who do. It could just be an education issue. There are some states who have forgone grand jury system altogether. Or only use it for certain high-profile cases. It's kind of a dog and pony show. There are a lot of other states where they don't have that process, and if the cops think you did something, they arrest you, they send it to the prosecutor, and the prosecutor charges you formally without that filter there. And if you want to contest it, you can go have a public hearing, okay? I don't remember, like, back in the OJ trial. They had like a month-long pre-trial hearing in public where all this stuff got aired out. I fail to see how that helps protect the reputation of people who are falsely accused. That's the whole point of the grand jury system, is a check on law enforcement, and also to make sure that, because remember, high-profile cases, officer-involved shootings, everybody knows who is accused. But 95% of these cases, you have no idea who's getting arrested in your town. And a grand jury is designed to keep it that way until somebody has looked at it and decided there's enough there. A citizen panel is looking over law enforcement's shoulder to decide, yeah, okay, you're good to go. You can tee that one up. And, I mean, it's a really important job. I don't know the solution for getting more folks to do it. Maybe someone who's been on a grand jury can suggest something.
Shannon, can I ask a follow-up question? I don't work a lot on grand jury issues, but I do know that there's a sense among a lot of people that it's practically a rubber stamp. There's this really famous quote, everybody in the room has heard it, by a New York Supreme Court justice, that a grand jury would indict a ham sandwich. And I mean, this is the impression people have. You think it's unfair?
I think it's totally unfair. Someone who's been in there and has had cases that I thought were legitimate, no-billed by a panel because they had a problem with one or another aspect of the case. And it's no-billed. It's gone. Doesn't matter if the guy comes up tomorrow and says, yeah, I did it. I mean, we're not going to reindict him or try it again because the grand jury already heard that. And so, you know, I know some people raised their hands here who've been on a grand jury. Do you feel like you were a rubber stamp?
We took it very seriously, and the prosecutor, DA, came in and had to present basic form of evidence, including any forensics, and if he was questionable, he brought in witnesses. So it was not, under no circumstance, it was as a rubber stamp. I mean, if you have somebody in there being indicted for the fifth time for felony DWI with his kids in the car, it doesn't take long.
Right.
But otherwise, no, it's taken very seriously. And as to the method, I think it's a disaster that something that went wrong in Houston has been imposed on the whole state for the solution, because where I'm from, you had a very cross-cultural panel that met once a month for a whole day to look at all the cases. And I think they're really struggling to get it done under the new system.
Yeah, and that's what we've heard. But that always happens, right? We pass bills so that we can pass more bills next session to fix the ones we passed last session. It's job security. But that's just the nature of this process. It's not an exact science. But I'm encouraged. Everybody I know who served on a grand jury, that's the response
that's
I get. And it's great. And I want to thank you for taking that responsibility so seriously. We really do have, you know, good people who sit on these grand juries and on our trial juries. One of the great things about Texas is we're populist in a sense of that post-Reconstruction setup of checks and balances, where we are one of the few states that have citizens look at a case before it gets indicted, and we have citizens who can not only render guilt innocence, but can decide someone's punishment, which is relatively unheard of throughout the rest of the country. And it can be frustrating, I can tell you, when 12 people don't think the same way you do on a particular case. As a former prosecutor, I can tell you it can be frustrating, but I think it's much better than the alternative.
Right here.
Morning, gentlemen. Shannon, I really appreciate you leading this conversation in the way of mental health. You mentioned sort of the lack of beds on the inpatient basis. I'm hearing more about the idea of outpatient competency restoration, particularly for misdemeanors, low-level felonies, nonviolent. I'm trying to figure out how that would work, what would increase comfort level among prosecutors and judges for that concept, whether it could be sort of structured as a pretrial program, and get more people out of the system, get them help that they need.
Thanks for the question, Doug. I would say, you know, the state beds are usually for the people who are in the worst shape or the most dangerous. We do try to do increasingly more at the local level, out of your jails, with your local mental health assistance. One of the problems with outpatient treatment, which means they're not locked in 24/7 with somebody watching them and requiring them to take their meds, is getting people who are out to take their meds. A lot of these people, you can get stabilized if they will take their medication and then their case can proceed, but those medications sometimes have pretty nasty side effects, and so they don't want to. And the mental health consumer community who represent these people, they call themselves consumers of the mental health system, they want to respect their free will to make those choices. And so it's difficult when you want to let somebody out to get recompensated, and then they just immediately, within 48 hours, are back committing the same crimes because they're not on their meds. It's a bad situation. I don't have an easy solution, but I know that's the concern, is that outpatient sometimes, unless it's highly structured with a lot of oversight, can result in these people decompensating, and we're right back where we were, you know, 6 weeks ago.
We have a question in the back, but before we do, I just want to ask you one question as far as some of the alternatives. Now, when you say taking meds, can that also be in some sort of, like, say, injectable? I know that's where a lot of the policy is going now, or at least a lot of the treatment's going now, to kind of assuage some of those problems.
That's a good question. I am not up to speed on that. I would think that, especially in a state where we get a lot of flack for putting a needle in somebody's arm to take their blood when they're drunk, that people want to stick a needle in somebody's arm to inject drugs into them, could be a tough row to hoe on a libertarian side.
Well, we'll leave that up to these gentlemen then. We have one in the back.
Representative Rinaldi, on the occupational licensing issue, one of the things that tends to be a problem, I think, at the federal level would be sort of the Commerce Clause is the thing that's used to sort of wrap every regulation under the sun. with occupational licensing, as you alluded, public health and safety tends to be that as well. And yet that is maybe the one real reason why you need to have occupational licensing. So how do you take something like public health and safety and keep it from becoming this omnibus argument for every type of occupational licensing? So how do you sort of, from a legislative perspective, discern what is a legitimate occupational health and safety issue that should lead to a legitimate occupational licensure program versus something that just sort of says, well, we need to license occupational license repairmen because adults in Texas are apparently incapable of deciding who to allow into their home?
I mean, you know, I think you have to set a standard, and it's obviously going to be a standard that has some area, you know, some gray area to it. Like, I would say a substantial and imminent threat to the public that can't be remedied by, you know, judicial process after the fact. You know, it's any standard you set is going to have some room for error, because a lot of the bills we debate in the legislature right now, they do use health and safety justification for it. Every single thing we pass is for the children, and we have these debates on the floor as to why it's not. But I think the first step in the process is actually to just set the standard as health and safety, because that's not the standard right now for a lot of our colleagues.
The Helen Lovejoy School of Analysis, won't somebody please think of the children?
Can I want to follow up real quickly. Well, I was going to note that there is an interesting example that came out of this commission report that I was talking about. We've got to really look at these things holistically, because these licenses start to build up year after year after year, and they start to make no sense whatsoever. So this is the example that stood out to me. There is a license we have here in Texas to be a midwife. Maybe that's legitimate. I don't know. There's also a license to be an auctioneer. I really don't think that one's legitimate, but maybe you think it is. Now, here's where things get really odd to me. We've got the midwife license. We've got the auctioneer license. If you practice midwifery without an occupational license, that's a Class B misdemeanor. If you practice auctioneering without the license, that's a more serious Class A misdemeanor. Why is auctioneering without a license more of a threat to public health and safety than midwifing without a license? Now, again, you could question the licenses themselves, but I just think it's unquestionable that this kind of disparity in the criminal punishment doesn't make any sense. Something like that would absolutely need to be reviewed.
Yeah, yeah. And we even had one as well, which I believe had a criminal punishment to it. We passed out of the House a reformation of this law, but we know you have to have a license to be a barber or a cosmetologist. You also need a license to teach barber school. But if you've been a barber for 20 years, you can't teach barber school because you need an education degree. So you actually have to go to barber school to teach barber school.
Even though you've been a barber for two decades. Yeah.
We have one back against the wall.
Fellow prosecutor. I understand the pressure of asset forfeiture, and I understand why you probably skipped over the question, but are prosecutor's office in the state of Texas funded in any way, shape, or form through the asset forfeiture function, or are different organizations that represent prosecutors funded through fees by asset forfeiture? And if so, would you consider that an absolute breach of ethics and the rules of responsibility for attorneys?
No. No, no. To be serious, so yes, different prosecutor offices may have funds if they prosecute felony cases. Some usually the split in Texas is after property has been seized, a court action has been initiated, a person has been provided notice and an opportunity for a hearing. They have contested whatever they want to contest. If the judge at that hearing decides to award ownership of that contraband, which is property used in the commission of a crime or proceeds from a crime, if the judge decides to award that to the state, then most arrangements in Texas are that the prosecutor who filed the case gets around 30%, and the law enforcement agency gets around 70%, which then go into separate funds, which have a specific enumerated list of things that it can be spent on. for official purposes of the office. And in some counties, you'll find that there are no forfeiture funds because they just hasn't happened. They usually focus around interstates and highways because it's highly related to the drug interdiction effort. And it is turned around and used to continue cracking down on drugs. So I know from the libertarian side, one of the advantages of attacking asset forfeiture is you are removing the funding mechanism for enforcement of our drug laws, which is, for people who think drugs should be legalized, is a net good. Now, if you have a specific question about TDCA, ask it. Don't pussyfoot around. Just ask it. Because I don't get paid with any asset forfeiture money.
Pussyfooting around anything. I was asking you questions. I didn't know.
Yeah.
What the mechanism is. I'm not from Texas.
Yeah.
But I don't understand. You know, going back to that thing, I don't understand how you can't see that as an absolute conflict of interest that the programs that you want to fund are funded by cases that you bring, and you know, people don't realize that in most asset forfeiture cases, there's no attorney. I mean, so, you know, yeah, you have an attorney for the criminal side, but for the civil side, you're on your own.
Right, and, you know, law enforcement and prosecution is funded almost entirely at the local level. So there are a lot of prosecutors who wish their commissioners were given more money to fund their office. Unfortunately, they're the ones who hold the purse strings, and they make the decisions over what goes to road and bridges and what goes to health and what goes to law enforcement and prosecution. The state has never funded prosecution or much law enforcement. The budget for the Harris County District Attorney's Office is larger than all the funds in the State Appropriations Act for prosecuting throughout the entire state. So one county spends more on prosecution than the legislature does. And part of that is because the legislature in the past has said, look, we're not going to give you money, but you've got this tool that you can use when appropriate to help provide you with what you need to get your job done. And if the legislature wants to revisit that arrangement, that's fine. And they have talked about that frequently in the past. But one of the things that we're sort of befuddled about is after the last time we made a lot of reforms in 2011, they seem to have worked in Texas. And we haven't had some of the abuses that you have seen throughout the country, which to me is a credit to our legislature. But they don't seem to ever get any credit or want to take it, because the reality is when you hear about a case from Texas involving a margarita machine, I have to remind people that was from 2004 when that happened, right? And the last issue we had with interdiction was in 2008, which was 9 years ago. And the legislature responded appropriate to those. And so every time we get in a hearing and people are talking about property rights and principles, we say, okay, if there's a problem in Texas, let's talk about those individual cases, and then we get crickets. And so, I mean, a lot of the problem is in the federal side, where they take a bigger cut, and people have fewer due process protections. You mentioned Senator Sessions. He is a huge proponent of federal asset forfeiture, and he said last year at a hearing that if the states aren't going to do it, we should be doing it at the feds. So before we cut off our nose to spite our face, I think the policymakers need to be aware of that and take that into consideration.
And I just want to point out on the other side, you were talking about specific cases. Those of us who are in favor of civil asset forfeiture would say, I could list the specific cases right now. Every single case where property is taken without due process, those are the specific cases where it's a problem.
Right. And I guess the question is, what do you mean by due process? Because there is due process currently. It's just not what some people would like to see. And that's where the debate is what level of due process you're going to have in those cases.
I also want to make one observation, because, Shannon, you suggested that one thing that might be happening with the libertarian mania for asset forfeiture is this ideological commitment to drug legalization or decriminalization. I don't think that's what it is. I think it's the libertarian mania for property rights. I think libertarians and limited government conservative types just get really bothered by the notion that an officer can walk up to a car and say, I suspect that this property may have been involved in a crime and they're going to take it from you. That's the thing that gets that crowd really, really riled up and rankled up. And maybe we are wrong about that. I don't think we are. But it's not the drug legalization thing.
It's not just an end around to drug legalization. I really don't think that's what's driving it.
No, I'm adamantly opposed to drug legalization, and I'm very, very passionate about the civil asset forfeiture issue.
Me too.
Excellent. Well, I think we have time for just about one or two more, so let's go here and then here.
Hi. So I work at the Innocence Project, and Texas has been a real leader on wrongful conviction reform, so I want to applaud you for that. You've implemented a lot of great things that we use to point to around the country, like eyewitness ID reform and discovery reform, but there's always room for improvement. So what would each of you do to help prevent and address wrongful convictions here?
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't have any specific policy proposals or anything that I was thinking about offering. I know Ruth McClendon led a lot of the charge on that the last couple of sessions, and we got some landmark legislation passed last session. So I don't know what's going to be coming down. I hate to not to be able to give you more of an answer on that. I think that is a key part of this whole process, though, right? If you're going to work on overcriminalization, you want to make sure you're only putting people away that need to be put away. But again, I can't tell you any specific policy proposals on my end that I'm going to be offering for that.
I was going to say, you mentioned that commission. They met in the interim. They came out with some recommendations. You're probably aware of them. There are many in there. I think the one that will probably have the most momentum is a move to try to record custodial interrogations, at least to some extent for certain offices. This is one of those issues where there's a way to do it that I know prosecutors would be okay with, but defense lawyers maybe not. There's a way to do it that law enforcement might be all right with it, but we may have a problem with it. It's certainly the best practice that we've always taught is that you want to record this. It's more information for the media, for the jury. But it'll be interesting to see if the sides can come together on a compromise, because past efforts for one side to cram it down the other side's throat have not gone anywhere.
And we have time for the one question up here. I do have to ask that we brief. We have less than 1 minute.
I think it was Representative Rinaldi who mentioned that there's a mood in the current session to decriminalize certain types of behavior. Could you explain and what is your position on those?
Well, it depends on the behavior. I'm very much in favor of bingo, and that would be one that I would be for.
Well played.
Okay, I got about 80 pages here, but I would be against decriminalizing possession of marijuana. I think a lot of the, for example, a lot of the bills that we're looking at now say small amounts and then categorize it as 2 ounces. 2 ounces is not a small amount of marijuana. I mean, if it sounds like it, but it's not, for example. So I would be against that. I would consider something that actually is a small amount. But that would be one example. We're out of time.
Yeah, unfortunately, I had to draw the curtain there. Everybody, one more time, a round of applause for our panel. So that's the end of our program. Like I mentioned earlier, we will be able to, we are going to upload this, and you will be able to visit it online. If you did not have a question answered here, please feel free to visit with our panelists. I'd also like to give special thanks to Shannon. It's not always, as you've seen, a amicable discussion, but
I tried to play nice.
It was very amicable.
Yeah, I made the joke earlier. We only bring you out for your PowerPoint, and you were without. But thank you guys, everybody here, for your unique perspectives.
Thanks, Derek.
Thank you.